is Chris Wilson. I'm the Director of Experience Design here at the National Museum of American History, and we're so happy that you've joined us for this third day of our second annual History Film Forum, a collaboration between the Smithsonian and the National Endowment for the Humanities to look at history on the screen. I'm really excited about this next film, and I think you are really going to enjoy it. These filmmakers, Hannah and Lance, when they contacted us, told us how excited they were about the History Film Forum and could have debuted their film lots of other places, but said they really wanted to come here because of this serious look that we are all giving. Not just the films, but the issues around film as public history. So we're really indebted to them for bringing their film here. It's a really important film, and you're going to hear more about that when we get into the discussion. To set up the film, I want to invite Lance Warren to come up and talk about the film, and then we'll screen it, and then we'll have a really wonderful discussion later. So thank you very much.
Lance.
Thank you, Chris, very much, and indeed we are delighted to be here. We could not think of a better place to share this film with audiences for the first time, something that we hope to be doing again and again throughout this year. I just want to say very briefly that about a year and a half ago, Hannah Ayers, the co-director, and myself, our understanding of the history of lynching was perhaps not that dissimilar from yours. We knew some basics. There was much we didn't know. And the reason the film exists is because as we learned more in bits and pieces, kind of accidentally at first, we became really powerfully convinced that the film had to exist. And because of that drive, and mostly because of the descendants, the activists, the scholars, whom you'll see in the film, and a couple of whom are here today with us, because of their trust in us and their shared conviction that the film had to exist, it does. So we hope you find it interesting, and we'll be eager to talk with you about it afterward. Thanks for being here.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Xavier Carnegie, and I'm the host of Seriously Amazing Objects on the Smithsonian Channel and also the My American Roots music web series for Smithsonian Online. At this time, we're almost about to start our panel discussion. Before we do that, I do want to remind everyone that we are going to do a Q&A right after the discussion. If you look to your left and to your right, in the middle of the aisles, there are microphones set up. And so when the appropriate time comes, we'll ask you to go ahead and take place there if you do have a question. I have a feeling we will have a lot of good questions for this one, so we'll try to move through them as quickly as we can. Also, if anybody has a cell phone, please silence that cell phone or turn it off. We want to make sure that everybody can hear without interruption what our panelists have to say today. All right, this time I'm going to go ahead and invite our panelists to come on up and take the stage. And as we go through, we will introduce them. Thank you all so much. First, I want to introduce the filmmakers, Hannah Ayers and Lance Warren. Can we give them a big hand for sharing their film with us today? So, starting with the two of you, what kind of sparked your imagination or was your inspiration in wanting to tell this story through film?
Well, over the last many years, I guess starting in about 2010, we've been doing a lot of work with history teachers. We were doing that work starting in New York City. And as a component of that work, we got to hear a lot of great history lectures, several by Jonathan. And while none of the lectures that we heard in the process of doing various sorts of teacher training work were specifically about lynching, little by little, in bits and pieces, we learned more about what it was. And we came to a point, I suppose, in about the fall of 2015, where we were, in a way, so indignant about the horror of this history on the one hand and how little known and understood it is on the other hand, that we felt that maybe we had a role that we could play. That's really what started it. We came to a point where we, as I said in the beginning, we felt that the film just had to exist. It wasn't a plan, but once we came to that realization, there was no going back.
And around that same time, the Equal Justice Initiative released their report, Lynching in America, where they published for the first time, or published new numbers, more research than lynchings had been previously, documenting over 4,000 lynchings in the American South. And so they deserve a lot of credit to getting lynching back into the headlines. And we saw that and said, okay, what are the human stories behind those numbers? What are the family stories? What's the resonance of those numbers today? So that's what got us on that path.
Okay. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Jonathan Scott Holloway, who's the dean at Yale College, also the provost at Northwestern, and was featured in the film. Can we give him a hand for his role in the film? Dr. Holloway, in the film, you mentioned that sometimes there's a discrepancy between the sort of official histories that many scholars recognize and the quote-unquote unofficial histories. There are these oral histories and stories of these families passed down. Can you talk a little bit about what some of those discrepancies might be and why it's important for us to kind of get that full picture?
Happily. So when I started graduate school at Yale, I didn't understand that yet. What we were told as grad students, well, there's the library, you go there, you find an archive, find a collection, and you find the truth. The longer further I got into my studies, the longer I served as a professor, I realized the truth needs to have little air quotes around it. There is a truth in an archive, but it's a truth. And the question really is, whose truth is it? And it's the truth of government institutions, it's the truth of churches, it's the truth of political campaigns. And these are important truths. I don't want to diminish that fact. But there are so many other histories, lived experiences, family journeys that are kept in family Bibles, that are kept in just somebody's brain, that are just passed along. And if we don't tend to those histories, we are getting an incomplete picture of the truth. And the fact is, most of us live our lives by those truths that are not part of the official record. The official record is out there in institutions, but we aren't all archivists. Right? So for me, it's about asking an important question. The important question is, whose histories are not being kept in those official places? And it's not just African-American histories, it's women's histories, it's immigrants' histories, it's laborers' histories, and so forth. That's what we need to do. And I think, and we shouldn't be afraid of those histories. I think it actually tells a remarkable story, makes this country more remarkable than it already is in an official way.
That's one of the things that I'm glad about for the History Film Forum is to give filmmakers the opportunity to kind of tell and document some of those histories. Well, thank you very much. I'd like to introduce Maureen Costello, who's the Director of Teaching Tolerance at Southern Poverty Law Center. Can we give her a hand for the work that she's doing there? Maureen, with a film like this, how does having a film like this, seeing it and also as a resource, kind of help you in the work that you're doing? If tolerance is something that we need to teach, what does this story do to help teach it?
What I think it does is it opens up that story for, you know, when we talk about teaching tolerance, we're talking about what happens in American schools from the time somebody enters kindergarten until 12th grade. And too often we tell a very simple story about our history and one that is very triumphalist. We had bad times in the past, but we're put them behind us. We had the civil rights movement, everything is fine now. And yet there's this disconnect because there are all these issues that are still alive today that teachers have to confront, all of us have to confront. The racism that still exists even in American schools. I couldn't help but hear the language in this film at the beginning about lynching was often a punishment for transgressions against cultural mores and the way people were supposed to behave. And it rang a bell for me because we who work in with American education know that one of the problems we face are these tremendous disparities in discipline. And the discipline disparities are that young people of color are suspended and disciplined more often than white youth, and often because they talked back, they were out of place, they pushed against the behavioral norms that were, you know, kind of set for them. And I think that a film like this helps establish a sense of, you know, that idea that this is in the DNA, which I heard that and I thought that really is very powerful, that not only is it in the DNA of the people who are being oppressed, but it's in the DNA of everybody, that we're repeating over and over again some of the same behaviors based on these beliefs that we've not come confronted in our lives. And so Teaching Tolerance, which is going to be making this film available in two schools starting in the fall, thinks that this is really important to kind of draw the curtain back from our history and make those connections between the past and the present that really need to be made.
And that school is really, you know, innovative use of films like this. As a matter of fact, the film and many of our films at the History Film Forum have used a little bit of innovation, which is a bit of a segue. Dr. Holloway, there's another side to this story, which is the innovation with which African Americans who were in this situation were able to make their lives and were even able to resist. Can you talk a little bit about the agency of black folks who lived under this sort of oppressive cultural norm?
Happily, I think we as a society, just for simplicity's sake, often spend so much time focusing upon when we talk about moments of degradation. This is a terrible thing, these are terrible things. But what we don't spend time also talking about is those people who survived, that those people who persisted, those people who showed up in the first place. And I find those, we absolutely need to know those difficult and tragic stories. It's important to understand who we are as a nation. But we had also better pay attention and not diminish the fact that those people who showed up the next day, and the next day, and the next day, and were determined to fight for their right as a citizen. They were determined to do different things. And you see that certainly in the modern civil rights movement, and for to be more precise, the moment, I find the history is fascinating when the figurehead people aren't there. Yeah. Like when King leaves town, what happens the next day? People show up, and they go to work, or they don't go to work, whatever the strategy is, and they respond in new ways. That is a critical part of the histories, that we wouldn't have had all these successes, we wouldn't be here had people decided to take a different path and only believe in what others told them about their inability to succeed. Oh, you're not gonna make it there, you really shouldn't try. Lots of stubborn people said, no, this is my country too, that's my classroom too, this is my job too, and I'm going to claim it. And that is an important part of the American narrative as well.
There are a lot of people, very strong, very brave people who took part in the film. I just want to take a moment, and she doesn't have to stand at all, but I want to recognize Dr. Faustina Baker, who is the great niece of Fraser Baker, and she was featured in the film. Can we recognize her with a hand? And her family is here with her. You know, we want to recognize the folks who have been affected by this and who also took the time to sort of make this film. I have a question for the filmmakers. What was it like, you know, trying to collect these stories and put them on film? Did you encounter any resistance? Because this is very hard-hitting, emotional stuff that still, as we saw in the film, still affects people emotionally, still resonates with them. Was there any resistance? Were people just kind of jumping at the opportunity to share this with you? What was your experience in doing that?
Well, I'll offer a prequel to that answer and then cue it to Hannah, because she's really the one to tell this part of the story. We had a plan for this film that we were going to tell the story of a single lynching, and that we would weave through comments from scholars who would kind of build it out and add depth and context. And we had identified a particular crime. And then we set out on this road trip to meet with scholars, including Jonathan, Mia, Yuhuru, and Isabel. And we came home, and we were stewing on everything we had learned. And of course, going into that trip, we had done a lot of reading research. But sitting with our scholars really hammered home things that we had read, and also really helpfully complicated our understanding of lynching. We came to see very powerfully that there is no typical lynching, that as we try to make clear in the film, these crimes were disturbingly varied in their appearance and their manifestation. And so we became convinced that what we actually needed to do if we were going to do the story justice is tell the story of many lynchings to try to give some sense for that diversity. And so in a record amount of time, Hannah connected with people across the Deep South to set up the meetings that we see here in the film.
We had a tight time frame for this, so within 3 weeks I needed to find people to meet with at each lynching site. Dr. Baker came to us through, actually the National Postal Museum had done an interview with her that I came across online and heard her voice, heard her story, her family's story, and they helped me connect with her. Kimberly Wilson lives in our hometown of Richmond. That was the first time that anyone from her family had been in that area in Charlotte County since John Mitchell had. And so that was a really profound experience for her, but fortunately she was willing to trust us and meet us there. Hattie, I found through the Moores Forward movement, does an annual reenactment of the lynchings that occurred there. So there's been news written about that, and I found her to be kind of their current spokesperson. Sunny came to us through an author, Jason Ward, who recently published a book called The Hanging Bridge about the history of lynchings in Shibuta. And Sunny, as you saw in the film, has lived there his whole life, learned about the Hanging Bridge when he was young, and still lives there today. Thelma was quoted in an article about something else, but I saw that she was the secretary of the local NAACP chapter, and I learned that she had helped create an exhibit about lynchings in Paris. So I reached out to her, and she was willing to speak with us. So we were very fortunate that all these folks, you know, they had previously spoken about what had happened, but maybe not very publicly, maybe not to the media, but we told them we were coming through town, that we would be honored to meet them, and we were fortunate that they trusted us to tell their stories.
And just to maybe underscore or emphasize something that Hannah's noting, one thing that we found this in Memphis as well, particularly in Memphis with the Lynching Sites Project, which is the group that Andre Johnson is affiliated with. There are groups that have already been doing a lot of work on their own. The Equal Justice Initiative is perhaps the best known, and for very good reason. They're doing admirable and needed work. But there are also lots of community groups like the Lynching Sites Project of Memphis that, if I'm not mistaken, was actually inspired by a presentation that Brian Stevenson of the Equal Justice Initiative had offered, where he came to Memphis and said, essentially, hey, you know, there are X number of lynchings that occurred in this county, in this city. What are you guys going to do about it? And it's a united force of concerned citizens. Andre and another gentleman named George took us out to this site. There's no path there. I mean, we were bushwhacking through thorns and trees, and it took a half an hour to get there. And at 7:30 in the morning in Memphis, and we were already soaked with sweat. I mean, these places are not easy to find, and so it's particularly impressive. And heartening. I mean, it's the only sort of kind of heartening takeaway you can have with this story, that there are groups like the Lynching Sites Project that are already doing the difficult work to bring this history to our radar.
Maureen, there's, you know, lately there's been a lot of talk about what is truth and what is propaganda. You know, what's news and what's fake news? And I imagine that there might be some folks who view a film like this with a good deal of skepticism, particularly if it's been used as a teaching tool. Even at the educational, you know, young people and teachers, how do you go about engaging those folks? Well, first off, have you found any of that? And how do you engage in those kinds of conversations with that skepticism using, say, this history or a film like this?
What we try to talk about is to understand that what we're hearing are reflections of people's lived experiences, and that that has to be respected, and that in fact, you know, we may disagree in lots of areas, but in some sense you cannot disprove someone's memory, their belief, or their lived experience. And so it has to be considered as part of any kind of dialogue, especially any kind of historical or civic dialogue, because that is part of the environment in which we interpret history and we make decisions about the future. It's one of the things that, you know, we most frequently talk about the current situation. And we try to point out, for instance, let's take, you know, another example, which is if we look at illegal immigration, that you can't just talk about it from the official standpoint. We really do have to have conversations with people who have made that trip, have made that risky decision, and who are willing to talk about what it's like from their perspective, because if we don't do that, we aren't going to have the full picture. So what we always say is that this isn't necessarily, you know, there is no one story. There are many stories. And the job of an educated person, and particularly of a teacher, is to make sure that those stories are heard and that people listen to them respectfully, particularly when they reflect our lived experience or our beliefs about the world. So that's how we try to do it.
Excellent. I think that's one thing that a film like this does with telling those stories, especially since it was so well done. We're going to open up for Q&As in just a moment, so if anybody does have a question ready or is kind of thinking of one but has almost got it ready, please go ahead and head towards the microphones. Before we open that up, I have one more question to ask for our panelists, and it's kind of the elephant in the room, which is the relevance of this film and of this story. And I was wondering if any of you had anything that you wanted to speak about on what's happening today, how that fits into either your filmmaking or how that fills into the relevance of just this story and why it's important for it to be told.
I think what I would say is that all of us should be aware from news footage, if nothing else, over the last several years, that the roots of racial tension in the United States run deep. But we may not understand why. And there are all sorts of reasons that we may not understand why, and we try to touch on many of those in this film, all sorts of ways in which people's memories have been pushed away from our awareness, from the records, voices have been silenced. And yet, with a story like this, with the question of lynching, the history of lynching, the thing is, I think it's wrong if we see it as controversial, because there are no legitimately differing points of view about lynching, right? It was awful, it was terrible, full stop. But we treat it as controversial if we say it's too difficult to teach or too ugly for polite conversation. It won't reduce us to talk about our difficult past. In fact, it will make a more united future more attainable, because we can discuss together how we agree that this sort of stuff is abhorrent and the sort of country that we seek doesn't look anything like this. So I think a story like this can be encouraging toward the sort of society that we want to have, and we would be wrong to say that it's too hot to touch.
I would actually add that it gives us a vehicle to talk about some contemporary issues that are kind of hard to touch. The danger sometimes of being a reporter, and the necessity, you know, I'm really, really appreciative of the way that you treated the Black press here, because they were voices in the wilderness and they were going to tell that story, even though that was a story that, you know, most Americans at that point did not want to hear. white America didn't want to hear. The other thing, you know, I look at is the role of the mob. You know, when you describe the carnival atmosphere, it certainly can suggest the carnival atmosphere of certain kinds of rallies today. So I think that, you know, you can draw those kinds of connections and really have a hard look at human behavior. And that serves a value.
I'll just add on one, jump on one point you just, one word you just used, the connections, that what I, one of the many things I found so powerful about the film is that by bringing in very recent events and then going physically, you too went with local residents to actual places that exist in the world today. Someone watching the film cannot disconnect these things. The fact is, the horrible tragedies we've seen with state violence against in this mostly black men and women in these clips we saw, it's not new. It's part of a longer tragic narrative of social control in this country. And by showing those clips and then going to the modern version, the contemporary site, the Hanging Bridge, so it's no longer something in a history book. Much as I love history books as a historian, nothing beats seeing it in color, going there in person. And to make that connection to a place, even if it's overgrown, something happened here, and it's captured in color. That, to me, was very evocative. And so those kinds of connections, I think, work in the film, and those are the kinds of connections we need to, as ethical citizens, be ready to talk about.
And just to add on to all that, I think the other connection we want people to make is how were all these lynchings allowed to happen? Public complacency. So we need to take a hard look at ourselves and whether we're being complacent today.
Wow, that's a really interesting point. We're going to open it up to Q&A. Folks, we have a lot of people in limited time, so I ask you to please be brief with your questions. And we're going to start over here to the left. Go ahead.
Okay. My name is Jim Lowen. I wrote the book Sundown Towns. I know at least one of you up there. Sundown Towns, of course, are towns that for many decades were, and some still are, all white on purpose. And they are mostly a northern phenomenon. And people think they're a southern phenomenon. And so it's absolutely high time we have this film, and thank you for it. But I think it has one flaw, and that is you make it a southern story. It's a national story. There are as many lynchings, probably, of black folks in the north, proportional to the black population in the north, as there were in the South. The reason they're not in the lynching database is because the original lynching database was compiled by two African-American librarians at Tuskegee Institute in Alabama, and they collected the information from subscribing to weekly newspapers across the South, and they didn't subscribe to newspapers in Illinois and Iowa and so on. And so there's a lot of work needs to be done, but we know now, especially those of us studying sundown towns, of lynchings across Illinois and other places that are not in any database. And I want to persuade you with my, it's not a question, it's a suggestion, that you come up with a sequel that discusses lynchings in the North. And I'd be happy to supply you with a whole bunch of them. One other little aspect of that, there are across Illinois, for instance, towns that are still aware of the fact that they have lynching trees downtown, next to the courthouse, for instance, and they actually, some of them did, and others never had a lynching, but they kind of wish they had. This is a statement of, and they are sundown towns, this is a statement of white supremacy they're keeping alive, but it's completely off the radar. None of these towns want these things recognized. You know, they don't want the rock taken off, if you will. So I hope that you'll think about a Lynching in the North sequel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anyone like to, by the way, just address that issue of the fact that some of this stuff was also going on in the North as well as the South?
Absolutely. The film doesn't have an official subtitle, but we often say, after noting the title, that it's a documentary about lynching in the American South. And indeed, to get at that point, you're absolutely right. pioneering African-American sociologists at Tuskegee, like Monroe Work, did so much to seed this work. But it is a much bigger story. This intentionally was focused on the South, but absolutely it is, and tragically so, a national story. There's many more stories to tell.
Let me just make one sentence. The reason why black folks wound up in big cities is because there were so many sundown towns across the North that where they could not wind up. They originally started going to rural and small town places, but by 1890, many of those places shunted them to the city. So that's part of the story too.
All right, let's go over here to the right, sir.
Hi. This is a question for the filmmakers. Just wondering if you guys had plans to either turn this documentary into something longer or make more documentaries on the same topic, because it seemed as though once you opened it up to be a sort of patchwork tale of many, many lynchings across many sites across the South, you dug into such a rich vein of stories, each of which could be given more time. And if you don't hope to expand it, what are the decisions involved in making such a short film about such a massive topic?
Mm-hmm. The length was very deliberate. We intended from the beginning for this film to be shown in classrooms, middle school, high school, college classrooms. So we recognize the time constraints that teachers face. We recognize the fact that, you know, something of this length is most appropriate and most flexible for teachers to use within the classroom. Absolutely, you're right. We could expand this in so many directions. We're committed to telling these stories at the history telling these stories at the intersection of history and social justice. So there's more that we plan to do. It may not be specifically taking these stories further, but I appreciate that feedback and that idea.
Let's go over here to the left.
Yeah, hi, my name is Jose de Arteaga, and I was just wondering if you could expound a little bit about, you learn a lot reading Wells and others in your movie around the lies told about African American men that white people use to substantiate the brutality.
Sure.
But I was wondering if you explored a little bit about the lies told about African American women that substantiated why they were the lies that were told about them that substantiate their brutality. And just to expound on what the other guy said around Chinese Americans were lynched and Mexican Americans were lynched and Puerto Ricans were lynched. And I think that if once you expand this, I think white people would really benefit from understanding that those stories too.
I think somebody like Jonathan could probably speak better to the diversity. I'm not a historian, so I'm not going to pretend I am one. But yeah, I mean, I think one thing that I hear recurring and that I really appreciate is that indeed this is it's a huge, humongous story. As Hannah said, the goal from the start, and this goes back to all of our work with history teachers, was understanding that history teachers have such limited time. I mean, I've had more than a few history teachers tell me that they spend only a couple of days teaching the Civil War. We understood that there might be one lesson, you know, one day, half a class period devoted to lynching. And so our thought was, how do we best provide something useful for that class period? But indeed, it is a much bigger story. Can you speak at all to the justifications, as such as they were, for lynchings of non-male people?
Well, the in the documentary, either I or Uhuru, I don't know which one of us said it, talked about lynchings were vehicles of social control. And that's where I'm not in the classroom at all anymore, but when I teach my post-emancipation African American history class, I spend a day on lynching. I mean, it's a 50-minute lecture, and I talk about it from the standpoint, so the class, this is a class in African American history, you don't have to explain the black or white dynamic, but I talk about lynching as social control. Like it is a grotesque version of it, but at its heart, because it's not about the mythos about the black male rapist, which is still with us today, that's actually not what most lynchings were about. They're about business ventures getting in, straying into white territory. It was, as you saw, you did a great job with the different headlines you ferreted out. People trying to vote, a rumor, you name it. It was about control. And when you're talking about social control, a system tries to control its most
vulnerable.
Thank you. Vulnerable individuals. It's African Americans, African American women in particular. It's the defenseless children. It's immigrants. It's laborers. So it should not be a surprise that lynching was a multiracial affair. And white men got lynched as well. I mean, this is, I'm blanking on the name of it's a book that accompanied his exhibit, which is a complicated history, so James Allen's collection of lynching photographs.
Without Sanctuary,
thank you. And the essays that go in front of the book spin to make it clear that lynching was social control of all different types, of all different kinds of people. Now, it becomes highly racialized and highly specific and mostly gendered, but the history is much more complicated than what we get in our small doses when we do get it.
I would actually just add one other word.
Ahead.
It's terrorism.
Yes.
And you know, and that I think particularly is a way to talk about it with students. Because it is, in fact, just like any kind of terrorism, its purpose is to instill fear. And so the display, the public display, is, in fact, part of the story, and it's part of the intention of it.
Let's go over here to the right.
It was a wonderful film, but mostly I'd like to compliment you on avoiding the lynching photos. I spend my days finding visual materials for television documentaries, and again and again, I get the request, we want some of those lynching photos. And when I explain, my understanding is it's a form of pornography. They were sometimes even printed with postcard information on the back so that you could send them through the mail. And so I won't do it, but they can find them on their own. So my question is, how did you come to that decision?
Very intentional.
Yeah. Well, one thing we noticed when we were kind of surveying the landscape, the media landscape, to see what information was out there about lynching already, it was really discouraging to us to see that for the media that does exist, photos of lynchings were often used as wallpaper. There were no names. There were no stories attached. They were just thrown up, you know, as visuals to illustrate a point, but you know, not recognizing that it was someone's son, brother, father, sister, daughter. And that really troubled us. So we decided that, you know, it was inappropriate to use those photos indiscriminately.
The one photo that does appear from Paris, Texas, we decided to show that photo, that series of photos in Paris, because it was highly contextualized. We hoped it was very clear who that individual was, what was going on. So we made the exception in that case. That's also why we identify the people in the contemporary videos at the end, because the dehumanization of archival material, which is not specific to lynching, this happens in all sorts of historical documentary subjects, was very, very troubling to us.
I think that because you guys were able to hook into such personal stories by showing the families of some of these folks, I mean, that it's even though we didn't see the photos, it still emotionally resonated. I think I don't want to speak for the audience, but certainly for me, it still did. It hit pretty hard. Let's go over here to the left.
Good afternoon. And again, thank you. It's kind of interesting that you're from Richmond, capital of the Confederacy. Interesting.
Fortunately, not these days, but.
Still, it was the capital for a reason.
It was.
And a lot of lynching did go on there. There's a book called Podology of the Oppressed. I'm sure a professor is familiar with it. It talks about the impact of oppression on the oppressed but also on the oppressor. So you see with this the pain, the fright, and the trauma on the African American. Has any effort been taken to examine the psyche of the lynchers? And I think that I'm hearing some words being expressed that kind of tie it to today. And I think that if we're not careful, you can see, or if you are careful, you can see a campaign slogan that kind of takes you back. And I noticed that in a couple of the responses, you talked about carnival atmosphere, public complacency, social control. So have you seen any effort to examine the psyche, if you will? Because if we look only at the impact on the victim, and all due respect, and I appreciate, and I'm very touched by your being here with what happened to your family, our family. But if you only look at us, and you never do an examination of the mind that did the rope, we'd be back there again, because we're only looking at this side.
I think it's a great point. Thank you for bringing that up. I think in some ways we are looking at the side of the oppressor too in the film. It's not in the same way, and that's something that, you know, if it were a longer film, I think we would go into. But I think, you know, with the help of the scholars' points, we kind of dive into how could people have done this? How did they justify it to themselves? So we tried to explain what the thinking was and what the climate was that allowed people to do this. But you're right that, you know, we didn't have the time or, you know, dedicate the time to examining what the psychological effects are today, and that's something that's very worth looking into.
Yeah, I mean, I saw you say that in some places the lynching tree was next to the courthouse. So you do kind of give me some indication of how state-sanctioned
Sure. Yeah.
But I missed a little bit in terms of, you know, the mindset, because we still see it.
I'd like to, and anyone who does have those kinds of concerns, I would like to encourage you to, when you exit the theater, talk to some of the folks about some of the films that we've screened previously, because there was one film, Slavery by Another Name, which kind of did go into that a little bit more. So that's, and that's something that definitely is of, I think, a lot of interest to filmmakers and to scholars. We got to get through these very quickly, so folks, please, please, very quick, very short with your questions, all right? And we'll start right here.
Thanks for your film, and also thanks for not using pictures, because the pictures, I've seen them, and they're so horrible, people detach themselves from them, because they can't understand that. I wanted to ask, and you touched on it a second ago, why don't we use modern words like terrorism? That's what it is. It's America's version of terrorism. And I think if we put it in that context, it will make more sense for people. Holocaust is a modern word. And when you use that word, it's powerful. People understand it. A lot of people were savagely murdered. If we started calling this American terrorism, and it's our homegrown version of it, ISIS doesn't shoot pregnant women. And we don't talk about it that way. And I don't understand why we don't.
It's a good question for the scholars.
Okay, could I ask my question, because it's directly related to it? So you can answer both of them together. You stole my question. Yes, I'm a recent graduate of American University, and what I studied is terrorism and security policy. So my question is, how would you link lynching to terrorism, and how could the Department of Justice be part of this very important conversation?
OK. Okay. Yeah, that's a good connection there. You guys want to talk about that?
I wouldn't expect this Department of Justice to do that work. both questions, comments, I think, are spot on. The word choices that governments, businesses, institutions make matter a ton, and they are weighted in a particular for all different kinds of reasons that you can use your imagination and figure it out. The simple example is like, well, we don't have terrorists in this country, which is. But this is, you know, the kind of assertion, because it helps make the terrorists be an other kind of threat, and that justifies expenditures and logics, et cetera. That's a very breezy kind of answer as to why we don't use those words, but there are people making conscious choices of behind which word they're using for all kinds of really regrettable reasons. And to the latter question about Justice Department's federal governments or state governments, let's say, making the effort to prosecute the past in more historically honest terms, it comes and goes with the political tides. One of the things that has been remarkable over the last around 10 or 15 years, I'm thinking, is that Southern governments, state governments, have been much more aggressive than before, which is not saying much, because there wasn't much aggression in this way before, about trying to resolve cold cases from the modern civil rights movement. There was this really fabulous, disturbing presentation by the scholar Rene Romano, a friend of mine, this is not a critique, who is arguing that the reason we saw state governments actually pursuing these cold cases is because, these were often white prosecutors, that there was a logic about preserving their own status, since it is no longer fashionable to ignore these atrocities, that by addressing them and closing the case, then a region, a state, can cleanse itself of its own past. That by looking at it, tying it up, putting a ribbon on it, it could make that the past and not part of a current understanding of what the South is or a particular region. It's a fascinating argument, and I'm compelled by it. So there are reasons of the most base sort about why governments, federal, state, local, will or will not pursue a deeper examination. And I wish that I could say to you that we are mature enough as a country to be honest about our past. I don't think we are. So I'm not holding my breath there's a lot of people doing great work, absolutely. People in justice departments at every level, in legal enforcement departments, even at the federal level, doing great work, honest work. But they are not the ones who are dictating the policies at this moment.
And I'm going to add to that. I work for a civil rights organization, and we've been having a lot of conversations lately about going forward. And the federal government has been the friend of civil rights for 50 years. And we are probably at the end of that era. So we have to look for other institutions to do that work. And, you know, I look at certainly universities from Georgetown to Brown to Harvard and Yale that are beginning to recognize the role that slavery and the slave trade played in their own past, and of course that means in their current lives. And I think what we have to do also is make sure that the story is part of the narrative that we include in K-12 education. That is one of the reasons that we are going to be using this film in our educational programming. As Jim Lowen knows, we are also looking at really examining the way we teach racial history in this country and making a really forceful argument for overhauling it and making sure that it becomes really part of every child's education.
Excellent. We have time for one more question right here to the right.
Yeah. So I had a professor in college. Her name was Crystal Feimster, and she had said, you know, that she had a problem with using lynching to describe the police shootings and some of the murders we see because she said lynching needs an audience. It's not just racialized murder. And I was just wondering if you could comment on the debate among whether it's historians or activists or journalists of whether that word should apply to all of these situations or whether it matters what word we use. And with if we do use modern day lynching, how the audience has changed. It feels like those murders try to get swept under the rug, but the Eric Garner video or the Philando Castile video or the Walter Scott video, the point is the audience is supposed to be activists. You know, we're trying to create a bigger audience when we're spreading those videos or when they're on the news because we don't want it to be hidden anymore. So it feels like that audience has changed from people who want to see these happen to people who want to expose them to the world in some way.
Thank you for the question, Cody. This is an alum of my institution. We are in this fascinating moment that I, for one, don't have an answer to in terms of technology. Smartphone technology is outpacing cultural mores, political practices. It's changing things so quickly that I often feel ill-equipped to make a learned analysis, to offer a learned analysis of it, except to say things are hyper-fluid and it's hard to understand. The videos that you mentioned are being consumed, and that's a word I use very delicately here, but in a very loaded way, they're being consumed by audiences on a scale that have never existed for this kind, for these kinds of actions. What that actually means, I don't know yet, because there is a way in which it is consumed by activists who see it as an outrage, and is consumed by people with very different, they come up with a very different message. And their use of these clips is horrific. So I just don't know, except to say the parameters of how we understand the consumption of these videos or these images, going back to lynching era photography and postcards and mailings, it has changed in terms of scale and scope and pace. I can only acknowledge that. I don't know what to make of it right now.
I do think, though, and the mention of the technology, and I'm somewhat familiar with the way white supremacist sites use these videos, and the fact is they use them to confirm their own biases. And just as those postcards were created by the mob to send to other white people to say, see, we took care of this problem, some of those videos today are interpreted very differently by different audiences. And I agree, we don't know yet what the big impact is going to be, whether the outrage out on one side outweighs the outrage on the other.
Would you guys like to comment on that as filmmakers and as people who kind of, you know, work with in some way these types of technologies?
I think in thinking about what lynching means, you know, how do you define that term, to go to your question, we focused on two criteria, one it being extra legal and the other being that it's socially sanctioned, especially through complacency. And I think something that a lot of us feel, I certainly feel strongly from the sort of crimes that we see in the contemporary videos at the end, there is a lot of complacency, right? There are people who are not being charged for killing another human being. One of the ways in which this is different in a way that is hard to know how to grapple with, because there does seem to be so much symmetry, as Isabel says in the film, is it extra legal? Well, it's being done by the state, right, in the person of, to take those examples, police officers. That's not extra legal necessarily, but this is something we don't talk about in the film, but one very common way in which lynchings began during the era that we're discussing is jails being overrun or jails being overrun, wink, wink. You know, the state essentially letting, you know, the jailer was overwhelmed by this mob. And what could he have done? So there are all sorts of ways in which the state has been involved. And I think grappling with that together with your really fascinating and important question about how the audience has changed is something that we need to wrestle with.
Please join me in thanking our panel today. Great. All right, everybody, take a deep breath. I know we've unpacked some serious things, but this is what this film forum is for. It's for conversation on all of the aspects of American history, even some of the ones that are tougher for us to kind of grasp and wrestle with. So we really appreciate you all coming and attending. And I hope that you all will be back later on at, I believe, 7 o'clock. Our next film is on Edgar Allan Poe, and we're also going to have a discussion with the filmmaker and the historian on that.